Hello friends, welcome back to another episode by Engineering Today, and I hope you're all having a great time. If everything stays on track, Starship will fly again next week. Elon Musk confirmed this in a post on X on May 13th. He also added something even more exciting. Just before the launch, he'll give a live talk from Starbase, Texas. In that talk, he'll lay out SpaceX's Mars plan. The talk will be streamed live on X. But before we get to that launch, a lot of prep work is already happening on the ground. On May 12th, SpaceX ran a long-duration static fire test of Shipthird 5, the upper stage that will fly in this mission. The test lasted for about 30 seconds, strong burn to check the engines, fuel systems, and vehicle stability. The footage has been edited to show the test from different angles, but the sequence represents the full 60 seconds of the test. Compared to earlier static fires, this one looked much cleaner. That's a good sign. It means the systems are performing well and SpaceX is dialing in the process. While Shipthird 5 is flexing its muscles, another major part of the launch system was also getting into place. The new booster for this flight, Booster 14.2, was rolled out to launch site. This booster is important. It's set to be the first Super Heavy to fly more than once, showing that reusability for these huge rockets is becoming real. The move looked smooth. Booster 14.2 was carried on SPMTs, heavy-duty vehicles designed for slow, stable support of massive hardware. Engineers stopped along the way for routine checks. That's normal. Sometimes sensors might trigger alarms or need a manual look. One thing people noticed was the number of wheels on the SPMTs, fewer than usual. That's because this time they were only carrying the empty booster. Unlike older rockets like the Space Shuttle or SLS, SpaceX doesn't load Starship or Super Heavy with fuel until it's on the pad, so the booster was relatively light, making the rollout easier. Once at the launch site, Booster 14.2 was lifted onto the orbital launch mount. This step locks it into place for stacking with the upper stage and preparing the flight. We don't have a confirmed date yet for Flight 9, but airspace and marine warnings point to May 21st or 22nd as the target. The final call depends on the FAA. For launch, they need to review SpaceX's investigation into Flight 8, the last test flight back in March. After a flight like that, the FAA requires a full mishap report. They also want to see what fixes SpaceX made to prevent similar problems. As of now, that approval hasn't been officially announced, but Elon Musk sounds confident it will come through in time for launch next week. We're about to see the most powerful rocket ever built fly again. This time, SpaceX hopes to go further with more control and fewer failures. If Flight 9 performs well, it'll be a major step toward routine Starship launches and one big leap toward Mars. The next few days are crucial. Starship is standing by, boosters on the pad, and the world is watching. In other news, Varda Space Industries just nailed another big one. On May 13th, the California startup successfully landed its third space capsule, the W3, back on Earth after more than 8 weeks in orbit. This return happened at the Kuniba Test Range in South Australia at 10:07 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. That's 11:30 a.m. local time on May 14th. The capsule carried important data and a payload from a hypersonic navigation test for the U.S. Air Force and Innovative Scientific Solutions. What made this possible? SpaceX's Falcon 9 rocket, of course. W3 launched on March 14th as part of the Transporter 13 rideshare mission. That's the same mission where SpaceX packed dozens of small satellites and payloads from various clients. Varda's capsule rode along, stayed in orbit for 60 days, and then made its controlled return. This marks Varda's second landing at Kuniba. Their earlier capsule, W2, touched down there on February 28th. Before that, the very first mission, W1, landed in Utah back in 2024. So far, Varda's success rate stands at 3 for 3. W3 completed over 900 orbits and traveled more than 24 million miles before returning safely. On the return side of the mission, Rocket Lab played a key role. Their Pioneer satellite, bus-powered, controlled, and communicated with the capsule throughout the flight. It also handled the capsule's release after a precise deorbit burn, letting gravity take over for re-entry. Rocket Lab posted a photo of the capsule after landing with the caption, "Around the World in 60 Days." Varda's goal is to make this kind of space operation routine. Brandi Sippel, Varda's Vice President of Mission Management, said it clearly. "High-cadence, routine operations is our goal. We're working to make re-entry as commonplace as launch. That means they're not just proving that it can be done, they're proving it can be done again and again." Rocket Lab CEO Peter Beck also weighed in, saying that supporting 3 capsule missions in just over a year shows how quickly they can build customized spacecraft. "This mission wasn't just a win for Varda, it's a sign of how the partnership between launch providers, spacecraft builders, and payload clients is tightening. SpaceX delivers the ride, Rocket Lab handles in-orbit systems and re-entry prep, Varda focuses on capsule recovery and mission data. Each part works smoothly, and the results speak for themselves. On the other hand, we all know that the universe won't last forever, and now we have a new estimate for when it might finally fade away." A recent study by Heino Falk, a theoretical astrophysicist at Radboud University in the Netherlands, has updated the timeline for the end of everything. This new prediction suggests the universe might go dark much sooner than earlier calculations said. But don't panic, sooner in this case still means 10 to the power of 78 years from now. That's a 1 followed by 78 zeros. Still so far in the future that no human or civilization we can imagine would live to see it. So why the update? Back in 2023, Falk and his team had estimated the final fade-out at 10 to the power of 1,100 years. That number was based on older models, but now, using a refined approach based on Hawking radiation, they've come up with a much shorter, though still unfathomably long, number. Hawking radiation is a theory first introduced by Stephen Hawking in the 1970s. It explains how black holes can slowly evaporate over time. In space, tiny pairs of particles constantly pop in and out of existence due to quantum effects. Near a black hole, gravity is so strong that these particle pairs get separated. One falls into the black hole, the other escapes. This slowly drains energy from the black hole until, eventually, it disappears. Falk's team took this idea further. They applied it not just to black holes, but to other dense objects like white dwarfs and neutron stars, the leftovers of dead stars. They found that these objects also emit a form of Hawking-like radiation, not because of an event horizon like in a black hole, but because of how space-time bends around them. This is a big shift in thinking. It means the entire universe is fading, bit by bit, through a very slow process of radiation loss. Even white dwarfs and neutron stars, once thought to last forever, will eventually vanish. So, what does this all mean? It means the universe's last glowing objects will fade away far sooner than we once thought. Eventually, there will be no stars, no black holes, no light, just cold, dark emptiness. But we're not there yet. We're still in a time where stars shine, galaxies collide, and rockets break free from Earth's gravity. We're here asking questions, building ships, and reaching out, even though we now know how it all fades in the end. And that's all for now. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting. And kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.